I want to thank you all for coming on behalf of the Institute for Philosophy and Social Theory and also on behalf of the Faculty of Media and Communication. The presence of our distinguished guest, Professor Jodi Dean, the author of the book The Communist Horizon, we will be talking tonight, proved to be an excellent opportunity to open our event, if slightly ahead of time. This event, aptly termed Reflections on Capitalism, is organized by the Group for Social Studies, for Social Engagement Studies, a research unit of the Institute for Philosophy and Social Theory, and by Institut Français de Serbie in cooperation with Center for Ethics, Law and Applied Politics and Center for Advanced Studies in Southeastern Europe in Rijeka. The organization itself would not have been possible without support and many active institutions which helped us. So Faculty of Media and Communication, of course, Serbian Ministry of Education, Scientific and Technological Development, Goethe Institute, Heinrich Böll Foundation, Rosa Luxemburg Foundation, Friedrich Ebert Foundation, Erste Stiftung, the European Fund for the Balkans, Cultural Center of Belgrade, Balkan Trust for Democracy, and Fund for Open Society. Now, why reflections on capitalism? To ask why we should reflect on capitalism in 2015 and in this very country would be, at least on the surface, a superfluous question. However, its redundancy is only outward, it's only very flimsy. We must ask ourselves, how are we to make statements or judgments about contemporary capitalism in the midst of its crisis, in the midst of its changing, in the midst of its turbulence and a revolutionizing process of itself yet again? In our call for our conference, Thinking Beyond Capitalism, we were quoting the Communist Manifesto and its famous sentence, which describes capitalism as being able to make all solid melt into air, which proved so many times to have the power to transform itself and to incorporate, even imbibe, the critique and social engagement which went firstly against it. So in this process, reflection is not an easy and straightforward task. It has to take into account the way we think, the way the thinking is made and unmade by our own engagement. Reflecting on capitalism needs to go beyond capitalism, to traverse it and cut across it in order to enable forms of social engagement which might break through the constitutive framework of our thought. So I would say that there can be no better way to begin with this process than by having with us our guest tonight. Please let me introduce Jodi Dean. Jodi is the professor of political science at Hope at William Smith University, Geneva, New York. She began as the history student at Princeton University and continued with her postgraduate studies at Columbia in political science. She is the author of 7 books by now, The Communist Horizon, which was published by Verso in 2012 and translated into Serbian 2 years later, published by Faculty of Media and Communication. That is her latest book. I would like to mention, among others, her blog theory, 2010, Democracy and Other Neoliberal Fantasies, 2009, Žižek's Politics, 2006. What those titles reveal to us are several prominent interests that I'm positive that we will hear something about tonight. So Dean's persistent interest in something which he dubbed communicative capitalism, then uses and misuses of democracy, and technocultures and information networks. She has also edited 4 books, Reformatting Politics with John Anderson and Geert Loving, Empire's New Clothes on Hart and Negri with Paul Passavant, and back in 2000, Cultural Studies and Political Theory. I would also want to stress, as a feminist, that her first book and her first edited book both dealt with feminism. Her first book was Solidarity of Strangers, Feminism After Identity Politics. So, obviously, Jodi wrote numerous theoretical but also polemic articles, and she took part in many debates. She's also an ardent blogger, a very committed lecturer, I would say activist lecturer as well, who has traveled the world to really disseminate her theory. And she has already been in our vicinity before. And not only that she's coming from Dubrovnik right now, but she was lecturing in MAMA in Zagreb and also in V-Screen Academy. with no further ado, I would only want to read Slavoj Žižek's recommendation for this book that we will be talking about tonight. That was the recommendation on the book cover published by Verso, which says, "This is what everyone engaged in today's struggles for emancipation needs, a unique combination of theoretical stringency and a realistic assessment of our predicament." Jodi, thank you for coming. The floor is yours.
Thank you. That was such a nice introduction. I really appreciate it. The jumping off point, or my basic thought at the beginning, was that the communist horizon, what I mean by that is the fundamental division that establishes where we are. So if you think about a horizon, right, people like to think, oh, the horizon is something far away or it's in the future. But I don't think that's right, right? When you're out on the sea or something, or when you're on a flat land, you see the horizon, right? It's the division, the line that cuts across, that's in front of you, that you can see. So I think it's this division, right, the division between earth and sky, that tells us where we are. So I wanted to hold on to this idea of a fundamental division. And that communism denotes this fundamental division. So it's real, right? The division that establishes where we are. It's actual, right? It's not something far away or off in the future, but something that is actual for us and real for us. And that kind of vocabulary comes in, for me, from the background in Lacanian psychoanalysis. And so a number of the arguments in the book use that framework. I'm not going to do a lot of that tonight because most people don't want to hear a whole lot about Lacanian analysis, but I'm happy to talk about that as we go through in the discussion. The term communist horizon comes from the Bolivian vice president, Alvaro Garcia Linera, and he said in an interview after his and Evo Morales' party won an election, one of the interviewers was like, oh, you guys are making all these decisions in politics, what's happening? What about communism? And he said, our eyes are firmly set on the communist horizon, right? It's that horizon that opens up possibility for us. And when I first heard that, I was like, that's amazing, right? That is still where we are, in a world where there is still a possibility to think beyond capitalism. And communism is that name. It has always been that name of a positive alternative to a capitalist system. So my thought was, okay, let's try to actualize this. Let's try to think about what can it mean to think in terms of a communist horizon now, today, given the 20th century. My primary motivation for doing this is to change the orientation of the left. Right? I'm tired of the left that we've had since 1989. I'm tired of a left that has told us, oh, all you can do is have like one action, or all you can do is have an art project, or we need to make sure that, whenever you say anything, have you already criticized your position, right? We have to get rid of it. We have to stop thinking in terms of a left that's all about fragments and performance and local one-offs, and think again about strategy and think again about power. Right? A left that constantly says, oh, power is the problem, will of course be powerless. And then what does that mean? It means that the world is left to be taken over by the right and by capitalists. Right? It means that there's no alternative. Well, I don't accept that. And I think that communism names this other possibility. So again, the project is one about changing the orientation of the left so that the left thinks again in terms of what does it mean to build power? What does it mean to cohere together? In the book, I use the idea of communist horizon as a tag, right? I'm also a blogger, and my book before this was called Blog Theory. So I was all thinking about Twitter and Facebook, and was thinking like, oh, what would communist horizon hashtag be attached to? And it would be attached to like six things. So the six basic themes in the book, or the six chapters that communist horizon tags, are the Soviet Union, a present force, sovereignty of the people, the common and the commons, desire, and the party. So I think about then this, I think about then communist horizon in terms of these six different items or elements or reference for communism today. So I'll talk about these six things then. So first, I'll say a little bit about the Soviet Union. Whenever I talk to people in the U.S. in particular about communism or bring up communism, the first thing that comes up is, well, what about the Soviet Union? Right? That's the first thing that they want to say. And they think when they say this that they're making an argument about history. And they think that, oh, well, if you talk about communism, you have to talk about history and you have to talk about the Soviet Union because that proves that communism didn't work. I don't believe this. What I don't believe is that my opponent who says, oh, it's really about the Soviet Union, I don't believe my opponent really cares anything about history. Because if they cared anything about history, they would have a lot more examples than one example, and they would have a much more open time frame, right? Because usually what happens is that my interlocutor who brings up the Soviet Union collapses together the new economic policy, the Stalin years, the Gulag, the Brezhnev years, as if this were all one thing, as if there was never any variation or change. And then it's like they'd never heard of the other parts of Western Europe and Eastern Europe and China and India, where there are all sorts of different kinds of communist experiments that were happening. So what happens is that what an argument that is introduced as if it were about history is actually usually introduced in a way that has nothing to do with its history. It's only, the only goal is to try to shut up me, or shut up the opponent to say, no, 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 you can't talk about communism because you have to first talk about Stalin, or you have to first talk about the Soviet Union. I think this is a mistake. Let me say a little even more specifically the three mistakes that are involved in this. I mentioned already that it's actually ahistorical, because it gets rid of the phases within communism. You know, in the U.S., the period when the U.S. was the closest to the Soviet Union was during the Stalin years. But usually my American interlocutor doesn't know this or doesn't care about this. Recently, a friend was showing me the cover of Life magazine, and I think it was 1943. You know, Stalin's on the cover. The article inside of it has a big picture of Lenin, and it said, you know, the greatest historical innovator in world history. Right? And this is totally, you know, completely enthusiastically supporting them. But usually when someone is bringing up, oh, what about the Soviet Union? That's not what they mean. They don't mean this history. They only mean to say something negative, something that concentrates all of history into one thing. Additionally, when people usually say, oh, don't you really mean the Soviet Union and what about that? They don't want to learn from history. They don't want to learn from experiments in self-management. They don't want to learn from experiments in collectivization, what worked, what didn't work. They don't want to learn about how did new housing processes happen. They don't want to learn about the increase in literacy. Instead, it's only done to chastise and condemn rather than to say, oh, wait a minute, weren't 60 years of history, didn't they teach us things that are productive that we can learn, right? Things that were useful? Didn't the people who undertook these experiments, who were scientists, who were doctors, who were farmers, didn't they have something to teach? And I think the answer is, of course, yes. And so I'm annoyed when my, you know, usually an American interlocutor says, oh no, what about the Soviet Union? Because I really think that what they're doing is shutting down. It's not like they want to learn about this. They actually are stuck in a Cold War version of history that refuses to listen to those things. Finally, the third problem with this kind of immediate thought that communism equals Soviet Union equals Stalin equals Gulag is that it reduces communism to an inert ideology incapable of change. It's as if all change in the world comes from capitalism, right? That capitalism is what generates change, but that people collectively can't make change. That communism only means one thing, rather than having meant a number of things over time, generating ideas and processes. And that gets completely erased. Well, I actually think that when I look around, the kind of change that we get from capitalism is generally bad and generally frenetic. And this constant frenetic feels like a kind of running in place, right? Like a kind of trap. So I'm tired of this assumption that all mobility and progress is on this one side of one economic system and no other system can be a locus of change. So again, this third problem with this equation of communism to the Soviet Union, to Stalinism, to Gulag, is this total static view of communism as incapable of being a formation that allows for collective change. Okay, so that's the first tag. The second tag for communism today is a present force. Now, since 1989, that might seem a little bit strange to say in Eastern Europe or Russia or even the US, but in fact, the American right is really worried about communism. They call Barack Obama a communist. There is a comedian, Victoria something, I forgot her last name now, and she had she appeared on a comedy show singing a song, "There's a Communist Living in the White House," and sings with a little musical instrument, and then that's circulated on YouTube and all of this, and someone was even a right-wing politician was even playing this song, before one of his rallies, right? Well, if communism was defeated, why are they so worried about it? Right? Why would they have to attack Barack Obama, who's actually in favor of neoliberal capitalism and bailed out banks, has installed our healthcare system as a market system rather than letting it be a single payer healthcare system? Right? He is not he's not even close to being a socialist. So why are they so worried about this? It's because communism is the one name we have for a positive world that's not capitalist. A positive anti-capitalism. It's the one word, and they know that. So since the economic crises that were building in 2006 and became a real full-fledged financial crisis by 2008, since that time, it's very clear in the U.S. in ways that, the U.S. likes to just pretend like, everything is great, everything is fine, bad things happen in other countries, but, everything is shiny and new where we are. But since those economic crises, the unbelievable inequality in the society has not been able to be denied. You can't hide it anymore. After Occupy Wall Street, and I mean literally, like December after Occupy Wall Street, a major polling group, the Pew Foundation, discovered that more Americans, like something like 73% of Americans, said that inequality was the primary problem in the country. Right? That's really surprising. It's usually something like taxes or more seriously something like racism, but they named inequality as the fundamental problem facing the United States, and it was highest among African Americans. They were the ones who were saying that the primary problem in the United States was economic inequality, not even, not racism, but economic inequality. So the economic inequality in the U.S. has become undeniable. It's on the table. And it seems to me then as no surprise that the right wants to make sure that communism can't name an alternative. Like, make sure that people are always worried that think communism is bad and are worried about it so that that's not on the table. And it's on the table because the actual idea is one that says, look, we don't have to continue with this inequality that we have. There is something else. So I think that, I've got this sort of, idealistic view that the Marx line, from each according to his ability, to each according to his need, is still meaningful. And that communism is that possibility. And that that's why the right, particularly in the U.S., but I think elsewhere, wants to make sure that we don't talk about communism again. Because it names an international, egalitarian, and emancipatory ideal that's more powerful now as we are able to see globally the ravages of capitalism. So I've been kind of talking about this right-wing version, right, of that views communism as a present force, right? So my claim is that the right thinks that communism is currently powerful and that that's why they're always using communists to charge Barack Obama, who's not even a communist. They also say things that feminism is communism, healthcare is communism. Some people said that having bike lanes on roads is communist, right? Because bicycles are like a communist, you know, mode of transportation. I don't think that's a compelling claim, but it's the name of their fear. But there's also a left-wing version of this, right? Or let's say a democratic version of this, where the left, or what used to be the left, or what thinks it's the left, wants to insist on democracy and multiplicity and not anything like one name or the communist legacy. Instead, they want to emphasize usually horizontality, kinds of anarchism, kinds of sort of free-flowing individual choice. We saw this in Spain in the movement of the squares when there was a kind of no politics, right? It seemed like the primary refusal was one of refusing politics in general. Fortunately, with the victories, the local and regional victories more recently, it seems like Spain's moving beyond that, actually, and moving towards a stronger, more coherent left. But I think that this this no politics version or this multiplicity version is the left form of a response to communism as a present force. And it's responding it's like the force that communism kind of hollows out is one of its absence, right? So it's the absence of communism that's present. So that's a little sort of a Lacanian sort of argument where the absence of something can exert a shaping presence on it. And so I think that the absence of communism, particularly since 89, it exerts a shaping force on the left that leads it into this fragmentary position. Now, why does the left think this? I mean, why does the left keep going with that? This? And I think for two primary reasons. I think the left is afraid of the people, and I think the left is afraid of itself. I think the left is afraid of itself because of the excesses and betrayals of communist parties when they came into power. Right? That's not a myth that the parties that came into power made compromises and made bad choices. Not only bad choices and compromises, but many bad choices and compromises. And the left is afraid of doing that again. And so that rather than saying, okay, we can learn from our mistakes and try not to make them, it's like, no, we just can't take power. We don't trust ourselves enough. We can't do it. I think that after close to 40 years, that we should kind of step up again and say, no, we actually can figure out ways to have a little bit more self-control and not react in the same extreme ways, right? But I think it's a left fear of the people and a left fear of ourselves and a reluctance to kind of take responsibility for power and start to shape it. Okay, so so that's the second part, is this communism as a present force. My third thinking, or third sort of item that communism tags, is sovereignty of the people. Now, I just have thought about this for a bit, and I'm thinking that, so in the kind of version of communism that I hope that we can all develop, it might be better to use an idea of sovereignty of the people than dictatorship of the proletariat. And so I want to say sovereignty of the people can function in the same way as dictatorship of the proletariat. First, I want to think about the people as a divided group, the rest of us, right? Like the Occupy used the language of the 99%. So this would be a non-nationalist idea of the people, an international idea of the people as that cuts through this whole organic or populist version of the people to say, no, the people always names this kind of disruptive force. And in the history of political thought, you can see this, right? Where the people against the elites is often, it's a kind of common name. And Georgi Lukács says that Lenin actually gives us this idea of the people as an emancipatory, or as a revolutionary alliance of the press, of the oppressed. So I think we can think of the people, and that this can make a little bit more sense today than proletariat, because proletariat seems, at least in how the term resonates in the context I'm in, is it seems very much industrial proletariat. And in countries that have been de-industrialized, where we have a lot of precarity and a bunch of strange different kinds of jobs, service jobs, a whole array of different jobs, that folks don't think of themselves as proletarians, though they might think they're proletarianized as an ever more dependent on unreliable wages and insufficient wages, so that they can think of themselves as proletarianized without being a proletariat. So I think, this is why I think sovereignty of the people rather than dictatorship of the proletariat. And I think sovereignty instead of dictatorship, because, you know, as we build communism, we still need to keep governing ourselves. That doesn't stop. Right? It's not like you only have self-government for an emergency, right? You have to keep finding ways to act together in a collectively responsible way. You have to keep finding ways to make your production fair, equitable, climate friendly. You have to figure out ways to distribute tasks that people don't want to do. So our own self-steering doesn't disintegrate, right? It doesn't stop. Right? It has to keep going. And I think dictatorship makes us think about political power in two temporary terms that tempts us to extreme measures, where sovereignty makes us think more about our collective responsibility to ourselves as a collective. Okay, the fourth tag is the terms common and commons. You know, Zizek has pointed out that one of the things that the new discussion of communism hangs on is the idea of the commons. And I think that this is right? Recognizing that things that we produce in common, that we share in common, our common spaces, commonly provided goods like transportation, education, culture, water, that when we start thinking about the commons, that this provides a new location, or not a new, but a good location for understanding production under communism. I also want to emphasize the idea of the common, and this is, twist it a little bit from the way that Tony Negri and Michael Hart do it, right? They emphasize the common in terms of communicative production. And I think that this is, and like, let's just say like internet or metadata that we produce through our everyday communicative interactions with cell phones, or actually when we're videotaped, right? That leads metadata traces as well. But I want us to think about this common as another source for understanding communism, particularly now, but recognize it in a way that is not the same as this kind of Negri potentiality. I mean, and here's what I mean. So for Hart and Negri, common designates infinite surplus, and they kind of promise a vision of communism with this infinite production of communicative surplus. I don't think that's right. The reason I don't think that's right is that under communicative capitalism, the production of surplus is a new kind of exploitation and expropriation. I can talk more about this in the discussion, but. What I have in mind comes from the structure of communication networks and comes from network media theory. In complex networks, and that's a network characterized by free choice, growth, and preferential attachments, the more that we produce, let's say the more articles online or photos of cats that we upload or music videos that we upload or books that we write, the more that we produce, the more inequality we create. And that seems really counterintuitive, right? We were kind of promised that, oh no, with the internet, everyone's equal. We're all equally producers, right? We can all equally get our ideas out there. But in fact, networks have a really specific structure. And it's called a power law distribution. And what it means is it's that inequality becomes exponential. Inequality doesn't follow a bell curve. It follows a power law distribution. Now, network science has mathematical explanations for this, but I can give examples that should make the idea true. I mean, idea ring true. Namely, think about blockbuster movies or best-selling novels or internet hubs, right? There's, you know, uncountable numbers of websites, but we could probably all name the top four or five, right? Google, Facebook, Twitter, China Weibo, which is their equivalent of Facebook, right? These are giant hubs that are produced as more and more people interact with them. It's not that you have lots and lots of equally distributed books, movies, websites. In fact, you have a very few that zillions of people know about, and the vast majority of which are small and insignificant, and no one knows anything about them. Now, some companies find ways to market these, like Apple. Yeah, is it Apple? Like iPhone? Yeah, that's Apple. Like iTunes sells all of the little things at the bottom. It's called the long tail. But it's still the case that the top artists are those that the vast majority of people go to. So it's not that new media is making everything equal. It actually increases inequality. This is one of the reasons that the increase of communication technology has been accompanied by an increase of economic inequality. The generation of many actually creates the few that are then monetized. Okay, so I call that, in the book I talk about that as network exploitation, as one of the primary, or one of the new forms of exploitation under communicative capitalism. There are other forms that have to do with working for free. More and more of us do work. Like we provide all of the communicative labor that makes Facebook and Twitter possible, but only a few people make any money off of that. That's something that should let us know, oh, wait a minute, why aren't those at least publicly held? Right? Why aren't those collectively owned? Why do just a few people make any money from that and the rest of us give up our data and information and time for free? Okay, I'm going to go to the last, what do I have? Like? Okay. So the that was the fourth one, is this idea of the common and the commons, and I tried to add in some discussion of communicative capitalism there. The fifth idea that I use Communist Horizon as a tag for is desire, or what I call communist desire. And this is probably, in the book, the most technical discussion, so I'll just flag a couple of points from it here. But there are two major parts of it. One is I'm trying to think of a communist desire as a collective desire for collectivity. Because I think that's something that we have, but that capitalism pushes away from us. And I try to theorize this collective desire for collectivity in terms of an open space or a gap. I develop it via a set of criticisms of left melancholia. Right? This kind of melancholic left theme is fairly strong in a number of different left tendencies, where you know the idea is that the left it feels very upset and sad and depressed and really pretty pathetic, and the reason that the left feels pathetic, we're told, is because that we are still Marxist and we haven't let go of the master. Well, that's ridiculous, right? I mean, in fact, that's unfortunately it's not quite the case that everybody's still a Marxist, though it would be better if we were. What really is the case, I argue, with left melancholia is the betrayal and the seeding of the desire. And this also comes from Lacan. Lacan says the only thing we can ever be guilty of is betraying our desire, giving way on desire. And I think that's what happened with the left, is over time we gave up a desire for an egalitarian society. We gave up a desire to discipline and train ourselves. And that's where the melancholia is coming from. But fortunately, since like at least 2008, we've seen this changing, right? We've seen movements going on all over the world with radical demonstrations, with revolutions in Egypt and Tunisia, then constant movements from, I'm thinking of Brazil and Montreal, and then of course Occupy. We've actually seen more and more people moving away from the melancholia that had been characterizing the left and actually manifesting a collective desire. Now, why do I say, and I really want to emphasize that it's collective rather than just a kind of bunch of individuals coming together. It's collective because people crowded together on the streets, right? They realized that just kind of, you know, tweeting their unhappiness or like, you know, going off into their own individual lives was not enough, and have pushed themselves together, wanting to be in common places, right? Expressing themselves collectively with one another. So I think that we've been starting to see over the last 5 or 6 years a collective desire for collectivity manifesting itself. Oh, and here's a plug. I'm actually finishing the sequel book to this one that goes through more of this account of collectivity and crowds. It's called Crowds and Party, and so that's the I also could talk about that if people are interested. And that leads me to the last part of the Communist Horizon, namely the idea of the party. I think that it's important to rethink what the party is and does, and I like to think of the party as maintaining the gap of desire that lets the collective desire for collectivity express itself. So that the party doesn't know everything, right? That's obviously clear. And the party isn't some kind of institution that can lead if people aren't following, but it is people who are fully engaged in struggle. So, you know, the left has liked to do things like say, oh, well, Occupy is great, or all of the contemporary movements are great because people are outside in horizontal groups, really self-organizing, and they're not a vanguard. Well, I think they are the vanguard, right? That's what the vanguard looks like, is people who are actively out there inspiring the rest of us to think differently about where we are. So I want to claim that Occupy Wall Street and the other movements that we've seen in their form are showing us the new potential for something like a vanguard and something like a party today. I mean, I think that at least from the U.S. side, that Occupy Wall Street was an event in the Badiou sense, right? As in, it changed things. It made it possible for people on the left to say we again. Instead of, whenever you said we, instead of saying, someone saying, well, you know, aren't you a white woman, or what about the people who don't have papers, or something like that. Instead, for a while, everyone could say we, without being refragmented. And that is an amazing kind of break with the past that we've had. So I think Occupy showed us that people, you know, involved in a left project, fully committed with the whole of their personality, which is how Lukács describes the Leninist Party, as a vanguard that was fully committed with the whole of their personality. So I think I will stop there and sort of kind of open up for discussion, and then I can fill in some more of the details as we go.
Thank you, Jodi. I propose that Alexander and I, both members of Group for Social Engagement Studies, begin with the discussion, but only with the first questions, and then I would call the audience to join in and to also ask Jodi questions. So, Alexander, please.
Okay, thank you. Basically, I just wrote two questions, and since you told us that we should get into the communicative capitalism in the discussion, I'm going to ask you about that. So, basically, the idea of communicative capitalism plays a key notion in your book, and you say that communicative capitalism is an ideological formation in which capitalism and democracy both fall within the framework of communicational technologies. And the reason for this is that these technologies are of crucial importance for intensifying the logic of competition. And basically that's what I wanted to ask you to elaborate on. Because when you say, when you speak about this capitalism, you say, on the other hand, that this sort of capitalism does not rely on commodities. Mm-hmm. and I quote, the social relations do not have to take the form of a commodity in order to for capitalism to generate value. And instead, they explode the very social relations themselves. So could you just maybe elaborate on your conception of communicative capitalism and on the last passage I quoted?
I'm happy to. Am I still okay with the mic? Yeah, okay. So my idea is that under communicative capitalism, capitalism does not have to rely on the commodity form any longer. It doesn't mean that they're not commodities. Yes, of course, they're commodities, right? When capitalism doesn't erase the previous form, it absorbs them. But it now has this other variation where it can directly seize the social substance. I'll use an example from New Medium. So here's the weird thing about Google is its algorithm, right? The PageRank algorithm. Because what the PageRank algorithm does is figure out what are the relation between different links. Right? It's not just saying, what do you, like, you're looking for shoes. It's not just saying, okay, here's 25 different kinds of shoes or places to get shoes or the history of shoes. What it does is say, oh, other people who have looked for shoes and who have search patterns like yours like these things. So what it does is capture social knowledge and feedback social knowledge and give it to you. It's the capturing of social knowledge, of relations, that makes PageRank, that's one of its primary algorithms, that makes PageRank work. It captures the values, first it captures the relations between links, and it gives those values. So, for example, it will say the way that it can rank things will also depend on people's the frequency of other hits that those other people or sites that would have forwarded it to would have that would how do I say this more clearly? There's a valuation that's attached to different links. That valuation depends on how many other people like each one. And out of the other people who like those, which ones of those other people were liked by more people, and which one of those were liked by more people, and so on and so on and so on and so forth. So that at each step of the way, whole sets of social knowledge are basically seized by the algorithm to deliver an outcome. Okay, that you might just say, well, great, that's an efficient search engine design. What's the pernicious thing there? The pernicious thing about it is that Google is a private company that's making money from this, and it's seizing the common relations for its own profit. We don't have to buy anything from them. Right? We're not buying any from them. We're just using it, and it's seizing our information, and then it sells the information it can to marketers, and then sells it off to auctioneers, et cetera. And then it can also distribute the data in different ways, sort it in different ways, scrape it in different ways. We have generated raw material, right? We have generated a whole set of a social substance for Google to sell and exploit, right? Those are our social relations. Right? Our basic social relations now taken over for their use. But it's not just Google, right? That's just one example. Of course, Facebook takes our social relations and sells them to marketers. Right? It takes your birthday's coming up. Oh, here's going to be various things related to your birthday, or your daughter's birthday, or your friend's birthday. This is going to be sold. Our social relations go through there. The same thing with tracking with cell phones. So it's not just that we can call our friends or text them easily. It's that that generates data as well that is seized and used. So our social relations can be taken by capital in ways that we're not remunerated for, and we're not choosing, and we're not buying them directly. So this is why I say that it can seize the social substance in excess of, in addition to, the commodity form. But capitalism is not relying specifically on the commodity form there.
Thanks.
Yeah, good.
Now that we started with communicative capitalism, I wanted to save this for the second question, but I really have to ask, I mean, in terms of what is to be done, because we have this rhetorics of access, participation, democracy, all that we love, want. I was trying to link the second and the chapter about the commons. Mm-hmm. So where you talked about the loss on the left, the loss of the politics, of the political, the feeling of the loss, and how we, I don't know, we talk, protest, make Facebook groups, make petition, disseminate mm-hmm. them, blah. And then on the other hand, we're losing will and will to organize, to work together as the crowd and the party. But so what is to be done? I mean, mm-hmm. how to be against mm-hmm. and do really something against this situation that we're confronted with?
Yeah, I think the answer is the party. I actually think that the answer is to stop thinking in terms of, well, I've got like three things I want to say. So the first, I think the party is the answer, which means organized action rather than distributed individuated action. I mean, we've got the distributed individuated action has a couple of sources. I mean, particularly after 89, the push was society taking care of society, or civil society rising up and arranging itself. What that's meant has been a great deal of individuation, and then organizations like NGOs and then markets. But it hasn't meant strongly organized political opposition with any kind of duration, right? Particularly for the left. Right? The left has thought that, oh no, that, you know, there was a time for, it seemed like for about 10 years, any solution on the left involved having a new website, right? If there was a new website or a new platform or a new social media strategy, that was going to solve the problems. It was this technological fix. And that was a way to get around the real kind of tedious, difficult, time-consuming, sometimes not rewarding work of real political organization. It also has the benefit of enriching the technology sector, by the way, which also is, I find, really frustrating. So I think that the answer on what is to be done is stop thinking about participation in a way that says, okay, you know, if we just have an event and have a lot of people participate, that's good. No, that's one step. And then I think particularly in when the frame is democracy, it tends to be the case that participation on its own is good without a whole lot of worry about, well, who's participating, right? Are the people who are participating, you know, right-wing nationalists, or the people who are participating, anti-Arabs, anti-Semites? Like, what's going on, right? Participation becomes its own value rather than, no, actual political organization of a left that can endure. So I think that what is to be done, I actually think, we're back in 1904, and what is to be done is to build the party now in a strong and strengthening international way.
First thing about your first point, I kind of understood you as any kind of anti-capitalism is communism, which I don't think is right to say. We have this like religious groups, re-traditionalized religious groups that are practically outside capitalism but are not even remotely communist. Then I want to make a point about commons. The way I see it, commons is always something common to definite number of people. For instance, common land.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So where is that communist universality within commons?
Mm-hmm.
And for the last crucial issue of political organization, I would rather think that all those horizontality that you were talking about is a desire to get away with the politics of representation, of classical representative democracy.
Those are great questions. Thanks.
Thank you.
So first, yes, not all anti-capitalism is communism. But communism is the one name that we have that directly and immediately is a positive society that's not capitalist. Right? So the other anti-capitalisms would be maybe anti-capitalism as an accident of a religious conviction, not because their first the first point is a society that's based on the production based on need rather than production based for the sake of the accumulation processes that benefit the few. So that's my first part. So I agree with you. Not every anti-capitalism is communist, but communist is the one name for an anti-capitalist position that is, that's clear. The problems of the commons, yeah, you're right, and that's a big problem. I think that one of the interesting things about thinking about the common and the project of communism via communicative capitalism is that at least we have one area of a kind of global common that can be discussed. So that's one thing. That doesn't deal with like real life, not real life, but the more material conditions of, let's say, the mines, factories, water, agriculture. And there, it's an issue. And I don't really have an answer that's theoretically developed yet. I think it's an open question about how to figure that out. In my kind of Jodi's commie fantasy world, there's sort of multiple integrated commons where different, around sort of transportation commons, science commons, health commons, in multiple loci that talk with one another. And that talk with one another, say transportation in each country or each sector of the world, because countries doesn't really matter if they exist or not. And then they would also then have to talk with, say, the agriculture people and the science people. So there'd be multiple branches off of that. But, at this point, that just is sort of a crazy word that says that says commons plus complicated. But I think it's an open question. On the horizontality and political representation, I wanted to talk about this. What did I have? I reject the critique of representation. I think the critique of representation is confused. I think it's confused because I think it combines two different, I think it's become a weird problem that combines some theoretical problems of what are the limits of representation with political problems with real existing democracies. And that those two have become kind of conflated, sort of like theoretical limits on representation somehow are seen to be the same thing as political problems of representation. One problem with the way that manifests for horizontal groups is they say they're against representation, but they act as if an individual can represent her own interests. So the individual becomes the locus of representation. There is representation, it's self-representation, that's it. If, however, you accept any basic ideas of psychoanalysis, you know there's an unconscious and that someone can never fully represent themselves. If you accept most postmodern theoretical positions, you recognize that the individual is a fiction, that the individual is an entity created with all sorts of exclusions. You represent its ideological structure. And so this idea of self-representation doesn't make theoretical sense. But yet, horizontalists speak as if, they can just say, critique of representation, and this has a kind of political theoretical coherence. So the first problem is it's basically individualist self-representation, but that's theoretically false. That's a mistake. I think the second problem is the supposition that you can have politics without division. Right, a representation is a division, right? I can represent my desire this way rather than that way. We can represent ourselves in one way rather than another way. Politics is not ontology, and it can't include everything because then it would not be political because it doesn't have a division instated in it. Any kind of political group right? There's no such thing as a political group of everyone, right? Even in Occupy, because like some people couldn't come because they had to work, right? Or they couldn't come because the place where the meeting was held wasn't accessible for folks in wheelchairs, or they had childcare responsibilities, or maybe someone forgot to let them know, right? It's always the case that someone's excluded. And that means that the conversation goes on. And we've got to recognize that and stop with the critique with and stop thinking that somehow the problem is representation rather than the problem being, no, the problem is that we haven't taken responsibility for the divisions that we're going to enact and given actually good reasons for it. And it's like, okay, what we're going to do now is to try to find a better way to let's say, produce energy that's not going to hurt the climate, but we recognize that a lot of people are going to lose their jobs, and we've got to have a safety net to bring them up and to not let the new form of energy production repeat capitalist forms, right? I mean, that's a representational problem, but it's not the same one as like, oh, no, no representation. Does that, do you see my answer? If you disagree, I'd like to hear your response. No? Yeah?
Okay. If we have time, I'll just pose one question. One short flash question. Basically, what you said about self-representationalism, it reminded me actually of a quote by Brecht when he said that the basis of society is not one man but two people. Mm. So the basis is a relation, not an individual. And basically, that adds up to what you said about being against self-representation. And that led me to look like. And pose your question about the state, the state and the representation. So what's your thoughts about that? And basically, I want to connect this question of the state to what you said about the sovereignty of the people. I think that's a key concept that we need to delve into deeper. And basically, the reason for that is that you say that the sovereignty of the people is a disruption. It's something that basically, in a sense, transcends the institutions of the state. Mm-hmm. And in a sense, what would be the relationship between your argumentation for representation, the state, and the sovereignty of the people?
Oh, God. Okay, in like 3 minutes.
It's
okay. So, first I want to make a polemical point. I think that it's part of the way that liberalism has become a dominant language of political theory that pushes left political theorists to talk in terms of a model of the state, as if we're going to have a new kind of constitution and a new, call it a contract theory, call it a larger state model, and that's what the job of the theorist is supposed to do. I think that rather than providing a model of the state, it's much more pressing right now to try to find ways to organize and build a party, right? I would rather build a partisan organization than a general collective, than a general sort of something like the state. So first thing, polemically, I think, it makes sense to try to push back against the demand for a theory of the state there. Second, I think that the state is an instrument, and that it's an instrument of power, and it's the instrument of class power. And I would like to have it used for the power of the people, understood as the people as the rest of us, or the proletarianized. And that we use the state to eliminate the rich. And by that, I mean by taking all of their stuff and redistributing it and changing the fundamental character of the economy. That might seem dramatic, and I know that there are risks. However, neoliberalism has been a project of using the state for redistribution. Right? It's been a project of seizing the assets of the people. That's what happened in Eastern Europe, is the seizing of collective assets and selling them off for the few. Right? We can do it the other direction. Right? I mean, that seems to me to be the project. Do it the other direction again. And then on representation, I don't really have a kind of model of what I think the best forms of political representation would be. I mean, that's just sort of not one of my worries. I'm much more worried about pushing collectivity and recognizing that the vitality of collectivity already against the way that liberalism wants to fragment us. So that's kind of what I'm push against us. I mean, I could imagine, I'd like to read other people doing this better than I would.
I would like to go back to the we of the book, because you really insisted on the we, and at the beginning of the book, Jodi says that she uses the we in hope to contribute to the expansion of the strong feeling of the collectivity. And you talked about this collectivity and this kind of trying to not help strengthening the individualism and everything. And so I was wondering, can you tell us something about your path from the reflective solidarity of the beginning of the solidarity of strangers to the we of the crowds and the we of the party, which is going to emerge soon?
Oh, wow, that's a great question. But it becomes too tempting to be I don't know, the whole audience is my analyst, and I go, and this is what happens. The one thing that was surprising for me is my first book did talk about a reflective solidarity of strangers. The kind of argumentation, the apparatus for it was different. And so it was strange now writing this book, where I deliberately say we, and I say, you might think, well, that shouldn't be that big a deal, but I had it happen so many times when people are like, what do you mean we, whenever you say we, that I'm like, okay, I'm going to claim this and occupy that position to stop this sort of incessant fragmentation. And to go back and think, yeah, there is that solidarity has actually been a question that's preoccupied me since I was a graduate student, just a couple of years, a long time ago. I think that's got to be because solidarity remains a kind of our kind of open challenge, and that what's happened since 89 has been a unraveling of it. But now when we see what happens when it's unraveled, we can rebuild it.
Thank you for that great talk. I read your book a couple of months ago, and I just have a question about divisiveness, right? You kind of try to reclaim this concept. You talked a little bit about division, right, in terms of the dividing of the common, the horizon being a division line. But I'm just wondering, like, what you think about, how do you think about the concept of divisiveness in terms of political organization, right? Because you said, well, we can use the state to reclaim the property of the 1% and redistribute. So there's no, you don't seem to be in favor of the political organization that the multitude proposes, that everybody's kind of in the same group and we all get along, and so we have to kind of reclaim antagonism and divisiveness. But then what does that do? I mean, that kind of happened in Eastern Europe as well as around the world when certain people were dispossessed, right, after the communist takeovers, and then that created a situation of resentment in the countries, violence, conflict that eventually flipped the situation too. We could argue that. So I'm just wondering, even though this concept is very seductive to me and I like to think through this, how do you think of conflict and violence in a communist society? How do you deal with people who have been dispossessed in one way or another? Or let's say they're the enemy because they're ISIS, or something like that.
So I actually hear two kinds of questions, right? One is what you could call the time of transition, right? The time of struggle, and then the other one is the communist society, and so how does one think about division in both contexts? I would rather focus on the first one than the second one, in part because of the general thing of trying not to have a general theory of the state or what happens at the end and all of that. And I think that we have to not be afraid of saying that there is someone we're opposed to, right? There's an enemy. I mean, I would say that the enemy is quite explicitly the finance sector and the states that enable that sector and that benefit from that sector, right? That's you could call it the state capital complex. You could call it the global financial institutions that are also internationally supporting them, and then the class that supports them. Now, I think they're real enemies. I think that we've got to not be afraid of saying that there are enemies that we're opposed to. Now, what does that mean? I don't think tactically, right? thing of like, okay, so we've got, you know, 5,000 people with machine guns and we stormed the World Bank. That's not going to really have good results, I don't think. I think that there needs to be a more complex tactic. But it doesn't mean saying that there's not an enemy, right? Now, could there, let's say you've got, the grandchildren of the very rich, are they class enemies forever? No. I mean, it's not the person that's the problem, it's the position and the institution that's the problem. Now, would the people in those institutions want to give them up easily? No. But why should we think that real political struggle is just kind of happy, oh, I'm going to share my view, and my view is that, you know, you shouldn't get $1 million bonus every year while this school's shutting down. I mean, I worry that this identity politics for the last 20 years has reduced politics to that, and we've lost the sense of strategy on a large scale and an ability to fight it.
I don't know if and how much and what kind of information you have about this country where you came, about Serbia. Maybe you do, maybe you don't. Here is the country, I mean, this is the country where the right-wing parties are on the roll. Those right-wing parties were previously declared themselves, some of them, as the left-wing parties. Even some of them were the members of the international left. Mm-hmm. For example, Democratic Party. And it appears a little bit later that they're nothing but right-wing parties with very conservative, even neo-fascist way of looking at things and behaving. So this is our reality. So in this constellation of things, what do you think people can do here?
I think the real answer is organize, right? That's why I emphasize the party. I think that it's the organization that is what we have to do. Because, look, we can say that the people who used to be socialist are now the bad right wing, or we can say that the people who used to be on our side betrayed us into this other thing. But then do we just stay there? Right? Do we just stay saying, well, now it is hopeless? Or the only thing that is left is small, isolated kinds of momentary, you know, either sinking into melancholia or doing some kind of small action for a glimpse? I don't think so. I think that the answer has to be organization. Now, that's an old school Marxist kind of answer, right? Organize, organize, organize. But I actually think that's what we on the broad left have lost is a faith in a kind of organization, and it's because the organizations that we've had have betrayed us. But then we have to try again. Now, that is a kind of, I mean, there's not going to be a magic bullet, right? That's a fantasy. But we've also seen that there has been, particularly in the last 4 or 5 years, with global movements, we have seen people coming together in new ways, right? We've seen people having more energy for kinds of collective activity and wanting it to endure. The problem has been how to keep it enduring. Organizations are what keep it enduring. Now, you are critical, and rightly so, of discussions, but I think, right, like the conference that's starting here next week and then the ongoing discussion that's going to be happening here in the fall regarding capitalism and anti-capitalism, that's crucial. That changes public perception. That makes something new possible. So I don't think it's just discussion. I think it's what helps shift the perception of people that can then create more conditions that make people have a kind of sense like, yes, I do need to be part of a new party that's going to push further.
I respect your vision. And I have a question. You very nicely and shortly explained how the game works on West. What puzzles me is in case we would remove wealth and opportunity to have the multiple choices like you have on the West, how would you motivate the citizens of communist countries and make them do or create miracles?
First, I think that there's actually not that much choice and opportunity in the West, right? In the United States, the data that says that we've got less class mobility than England did in like the 16th century, right? Like, you take some kind of total aristocracy, and we've got less class mobility than that. The likelihood of someone in one of the bottom two quintiles, so that's lowest 20% and lowest 40% of the population, of remaining poor is over 50%, right? So the likelihood of any kind of class change is basically 50-50. That's really stark. So I think, first of all, and one of the things that's actually interesting now, again, over the last 5 or 6 years, in part because of the movements, in part because of the economic crisis, more and more people are recognizing that the so-called American dream is an illusion in the U.S. That is lessening the hold of capitalism. Right? Folks realize that it's actually capitalism that's preventing them from having some kind of choice and opportunity. So I think the first part of addressing your question is kind of challenging the presupposition that capitalism provides those sort of opportunities. And throughout most of capitalism's history, for the working class, the goal of capitalism has been reproducing a working class. It has to have that to keep going. And so opportunity has always been a little bit of a pipe dream. I think in the ideal communist future, we'll have to figure out what are going to be good ways to distribute tasks. Right now, one of the things that's interesting is the number of people necessary for reproducing basic goods in society is decreasing, which gives a lot more free time. I'll tell you honestly, this is now not a very theoretical answer. It just shows that, I grew up in the 60s, but I mean, I think we need a better space program, right? I think that that's really exciting. I think that that science and health questions are really exciting. I think that addressing global climate change is a massive global project to figure out better ways of living, of producing kinds of energy that won't be increasing warming dramatically. So it seems to me that in our ideal communist future, that creating lots of opportunities for people who are studying and learning and doing those things would be great, and that folks would want to do it. It's not like you have to give some sort of financial incentive. People want to do it because it's cool.
As I understood, your basic answer to the question of organizational form of left today is particularly party. And if we have a party, we have a state. And if we have a state, we do have certain forms of inequality that the state produces and reproduces. And a first question would be, how could we guarantee that those kind of inequality won't reflect itself on the society? And the other one, and this could be probably a little bit funky, is what is your position, and not just your position, like personally yours, but that position that you're kind of advocating here, and I would call it state socialism. What is it different from the, I don't know, Soviet Union's position in 45? Because if we're talking in new left projects, and if you're talking of new mass movements that we had opportunity to see in last few years, I really need just in a few, theses, what's the difference between that and this? Thank you.
That's a lot of big questions for a short answer. So first, in politics, there's no guarantees. Right, so we've got to stop thinking that we have to have all of the guarantees. I mean, think of an analogy. If you, if you're getting married to someone, you can't say, "I can guarantee you forever that this will be the case." You just make the jump and you make the commitment. And I think that we have to recognize that there will be no guarantees. Second, I think that for forms of state inequality, that I think there are at least two ways to deal with that. One is by really disconnecting economic slash material benefit from political responsibility. that those have to be really disconnected so that there's less of an incentive to corruption. I also think that rotating people in and out of offices in multiple ways, that that's another help. But it's, you know, it's the case when any kind of any organization with people is going to run a risk of reproducing inequalities. And so, you know, I also think a strong collectivist ideology helps too, right? So there can be more sort of cultural, ethical, normative ways other than just rules. How is my model different from state socialism? I hope in a lot of ways, but one way would be it's not a... I haven't said anything about this, so there's no reason this has come up, but I would think it wouldn't be productivist in terms of a very specific account of having to increase industrial production in a heavy industry way. I think that led to very specific problems. I also think that I'm not sure about this. I'm not inclined to have. I'm not inclined for a state a unity of one party and state. I'm kind of inclined to multiple parties, but I think it should be like Trotskyist party, Maoist party, anarchist party, Bolshevik party. So you could have like at least 10 communist parties, but that's it. Thank you all.